everybody. I'm so glad that everybody was able to make it on another snowy day after a huge amount of snow the other day. I really appreciate that. And welcome. The Salisbury Association Historical Society and the Scoville Memorial Library are thrilled to present another year of the Era of Elegance. And Dick Boyle, an art historian, has so kindly agreed to do Salisbury faces for us, which are the portraits in the collection of the Salisbury Association, which is it's a wonderful collection that we have, and a lot of people haven't seen it, they're not aware of it. So it's really nice for Dick to introduce all of us to it. And as we all know from past lectures that Dick has given, he always does a great job with anecdotes and stories about the artists and their subjects. So he makes it come alive, which is quite wonderful. Dick is a former museum director of the Pennsylvania Academy of the Fine Arts, which is in Philadelphia. He's also a former art history professor at Temple University. And he is our resident art historian, and he keeps us all apprised of the different art that we have available. So we're really fortunate. I would like to make two announcements. One is that the exit is behind, and there's an exit door here. And if we need to evacuate, there's two exits. The bathroom is through the glass door at the end of the corridor on the left. The other thing that is coming up next week, and I'll announce this after as well as before, is Exploring Great Art Through Old Master Drawings. It's going to be next Saturday, February 22nd at 4 p.m. Mayo Weiner is going to be giving a presentation on old master drawings. So it should be another really dynamic presentation. With all of that, we will now introduce Dick Boyle, and he will begin with his presentation on Salisbury faces.
Thank you. It looks like you are all the members of Shackleton's crew tonight. Before I start, I do want to thank, so I don't forget and have people mad at me. I want to thank Catherine Chilcote and Laura at the Salisbury Association for their help, Chris Brennan, and of course the entire library staff, Claudia and her library staff, for helping us put this whole thing together. I call it Salisbury Faces, but I think what I'm interested in is not so much, thank you, what I'm interested in is not so much the genealogy of portraiture, or what John Singer Sargent's definition of the portrait of portrait painting was that portrait painting is painting where there's always something wrong with the nose. And I'm not really interested in noses, and I'm not really interested in the genealogy of the portrait, the sort of family history behind it, except in certain instances. For that, you must see what I call Catherine Chilcote's Bible. Catherine Chilcote had put together an enormous work. There's a book about that thick of all of the paintings listed in the collection, public collections in Salisbury. So, the town hall, the library, and the Salisbury Association among them. So if you really want to get into more detail than I'm going to give you, I suggest that you talk to our eminent town historian and ask for the book. And speaking of Catherine Chilcote, I'm going to quote, before I embarrass her any further, I'm going to quote a statement that she made, that there is a surprising amount of art in Salisbury's public buildings, much of which is portraiture, my words, about which I'm speaking today. So what I'm really interested in is the, not so much the noses, but the kind of style that goes into a portrait, its context, and particularly with the Salisbury Association's portraits. What is the context of the association's portraits in the flow of American portraiture? So I want to start with a brief look at the history of American portraits. Now, obviously, this would take us several weeks, but we are condensing it in true Time magazine style. So that's generally what I'm really interested in. I'm interested in style, and I'm interested in the historical aspects and cultural meaning of the portrait. You know, a lot of people think, there's going to be an exhibition of portraits, there's going to be a talk on portraits, who cares, it's boring. But yet, if you really delve into it, it can reveal something very definite about the time in which, the historical time and the times in which we live as well, like any art. The portrait has always been an important part of American art. In fact, you might say it was the mainstay for a very long time, from the colonial era, such as this, right through to the present day, but especially earlier, the portrait was the kernel of American art. Now, what is it exactly? I mean, it's an example of status. If you look at the Renaissance portraits, this was a celebration of man and his place in society and in the world. It's a record, a family record, and it can be used for practical purposes. Particularly in early times, the portrait was when people became engaged to be married, they gave each other portraits of themselves. So it has all of these things. But let's look, and the Salisbury Association's collection, basically, in looking at it, the strength of it appears to be in the era of sort of the 1830s and 1840s, with with its strength in that era. So we will get to that in a minute. I did have some earlier portraits than this, but for some reason or other, they wouldn't take on my disc. And once again, technology.
Dick?
Technology has.
Dick?
Yeah.
The portrait is a little out of focus.
Yeah, that's.
That's.
Yeah, I know that.
Okay.
Because it's my fault.
Okay.
That's my photography.
Oh, okay.
It's not the portrait's fault or your eyes.
Got it. All right. Thank you.
This fuzzy portrait is a portrait of Pierre Van Cortlandt. It was done in 1730 by a Dutch artist. And I did have, as I mentioned, two earlier portraits. I had a marvelous portrait by Gainsborough, which was very popular in America in the 1920s, called The Blue Boy, which is in the Huntington Gallery, Huntington Library and Gallery in San Marino, California. And it was a picture that was very influential in colonial times, as well as right up through the 1920s with the American establishment. But unfortunately, that was the ones that didn't take. And that was a very sophisticated painting from which, of course, artists who came to this country in colonial times brought with them. They brought that style with them, even though perhaps technically, like this, technically they weren't up to it. If we go even further, if we start with this and think, well, okay, this was an itinerant painter who either came with the colonists or came later because he wanted to work in the colonies. He figured that there would be customers for him. Whether it was worth a month's trip on the Atlantic is another story. But anyway, let's go on to the next one. Whoops. Ah,
whoops. Oh, too much.
Oh, too much. There we are. So if we then jump to Gilbert Stuart's celebrated Lansdowne portrait of George Washington, which is everywhere. It's in the White House, it's in the State Department, it's in the National Gallery. There's a version in the Pennsylvania Academy of the Fine Arts. We go from the portrait of Pierre Van Cortlandt and that kind of naive, linear, and somewhat untutored style to this very sophisticated, what I call the imperial style of George Washington portraits by Gilbert Stuart, who was the eminent portrait painter of the American establishment in the colonial and federal period, mostly the federal period. In fact, this particular picture was borrowed from a Roman sculpture, which was very appropriate because the founding fathers found the early Roman Republic as an inspiration. Mm-hmm. So here we have Gilbert Stuart in a very flashy, classy style. Really building up to a very sophisticated portrait tradition in the States. If I can somehow. Here we are. Aha! So, but the most talented and skilled portrait painter in the colonial period was John Singleton Copley, who's this is a portrait of a Mrs. Bowers, done in the 1760s. The Gilbert Stuart was painted in 1796, so that was well into the federal period. And when you think about it, Copley is a colonial painter, which meant, of course, that we were a colony. We were not yet a nation. And so, hence the colonial portraiture. Stuart, on the other hand, was painting when we had become a nation and we needed an art to celebrate that particular transition from mm-hmm. colonial status to national status. But Copley was a major figure. And again, if you can remember that early portrait of Van Cortlandt, what we have is a tremendously skilled artist who painted everyone who counted, mostly in Boston, in the colonies, but was never happy here. He married the daughter of a Tory administrator and left this country in about 1774. So he wanted to go to London, which of course was the place at that time. This was before Paris, before American artists fled to, to Paris. London was the place to go if you wanted to become a serious painter. And again, serious painting in the colonies meant portraits. Mm-hmm. Copley was tired of painting portraits. He wanted to paint history pictures, which was the height of what an artist could and should do. But if you look at that, even in my terrible slide, it is an incredible treatment of the stuffs, setting her in a background, a country seat, the country house seat background, which is part of the English tradition of the grand manor, and he wanted to go to the place where it was originally came from. Now, if we then compare this to the next picture, which is attributed to Erastus Salisbury Field, one of the itinerant portrait painters in the mid-19th century. One other such painter in Salisbury's collection, Erastus Salisbury Field and Ami Phillips, who were relatively untrained. And this is what I call the sort of third tier of American portrait painting. First, you had the portraits in the grand manner, which continued right through artists who were trained professionally to do this. And you had self-trained artists who painted in this manner. That's the sort of almost the complete opposite. And in the middle was a sort of a style that came, that was realistic and trained, but not in the style of, not in the grand aristocratic manner. We'll see some of those here. Well, you might say that Ellen Emmett Rand, for example, is one of that type of painter. She had essays into the grand manner style, as we'll see, very much influenced by John Singer Sargent. But her portrait, for example, of Judge Warner, which is owned by the by the town and is in Town Hall, is an extraordinarily marvelous piece of realistic painting. So let's go back, but I wanted to show this sort of out of place in a way, and contrast to that John Singleton Copley picture, and it's an incredible sophisticated painting, even though it's earlier. Mm-hmm. So it shows that art often does not progress in a straight line. It is circular and backtracking and often self-referential. So you have painters like this, like Erastus Salisbury Field. There's a marvelous picture in the Athenaeum in Hartford. A huge sort of imaginary city. He was an extraordinary painter, and he and Phillips both just got on their horse, so to speak, not on their high horse, but their horse, and rode all over Connecticut and New York painting portraits. They were itinerant portrait painters. So that's one style we want to look at. This is Jane Lyman Holly, who was the first wife of Alexander Holly, painted about 1830. Now, I do want to mention one thing, that there is a number of portraits of members of the Holly family and their relations in the Salisbury Association's collection. And it's interesting that that this one family had made such an impact in the town, and that's what comes out of so many portraits of the same family. Why do we have so many portraits of the same family? Because they obviously were important. They obviously made their contribution to the town. I think this picture actually was found in the Holly Williams house, which used to be owned by the, as you know, by the Salisbury Association, and is now in private hands and has been brilliantly restored. This was found rolled up in the attic of the Holly Williams house. There was another one that was also found sort of, and I myself once found a painting tucked away behind an old sofa, been there for years, which on one hand is kind of fun, on the other it's sort of appalling, you know. But that's what happens. And this is Uncle George. We'll put him over here. But again, I point out that that's what the portraits, that's what a portrait can do, is reveal something about not just the family, but the time, and so forth. So we have an example of this kind of painting, and I show this picture, which is not in the Holly, not in the Salisbury collection, but is a portrait by Thomas Aikens, the famous Philadelphia realist painter, and it's an example of his realism. It's a portrait of one of the University of Pennsylvania professors whom he knew, Professor Marx, who was a professor of engineering. And I show this as an example of that form of realism about which I mentioned before, that Aikens was a prime example of a gritty kind of realism. No holds barred, warts and all kind of approach to portrait painting. So, so with that in mind, we'll kind of proceed to the some of the portraits now in the collection. And there's an early portrait by an artist unknown of Alexander Hamilton Holly, perhaps his husband of Jane, perhaps around 1830 or so. There's no date, but it's possible. I found that in looking, in preparing for the lecture and in looking at the association's pictures, as I mentioned before, they all seem to fall within that period of 1830s, 1840s. That's Alexander. That's a very nice charcoal drawing. Sometimes these charcoal drawings, it has that look, you know, it has that staring look that comes from, sometimes comes from an artist looking at a photograph rather than an actual person. You know, because especially these early pictures, which maybe would make this perhaps a little later than 1830, certainly, because of that kind of, there's the possibility that if it was taken from a daguerreotype, that would have been after 1841, or after 1839 when the daguerreotype was invented. So what you've got here is he's, but it's a wonderful drawing. Sometimes these artists would also actually draw over a photograph, and that was considered okay. That was not looked down on. But or either that, or they copied from a photograph if the subject wasn't there. Thomas Eakins himself used photography a great deal. He used it as a tool, and being a realist painter, that makes a lot of sense. So let's go on to another pair of paintings that were attributed to Erastus Salisbury Field. And this is a portrait of Albert Moore, who was a Salisbury town treasurer and later a probate judge, from treasurer to judge. That's okay. Painted about 1840. So if we look at this, the way this is, we have no, neither Catherine or I could quite figure out what the homestead was all about, why he was holding that particular pamphlet or paper. It would be kind of fun to find out. We couldn't find whether or not such a thing actually existed in that period. But here you see that style, not as naive as the Jane Lyman Holly picture, a little bit more technically proficient, but still with that very linear, direct kind of a painting style that is characteristic of the itinerant portrait painter. I mean, after all, that's what his clients wanted, a likeness. And anything else you did with it was okay with them, as long as you gave them their likeness. So that's, and again, attributed only to Salisbury, Erastus Salisbury Field, as was his wife, Jane Moore. And it's actually very charming. I think this is kind of captured a good deal of charm. She's holding a fan, and often the wife of, in a pair of portraits in America and this period, she would have been holding a Bible. But in this case, it's a fan, which is really sort of a, almost like a throwback to 18th century French pictures, which would have been the furthest thing possible from the life represented by this sitter. And if we sort of move on to the next artist.
Yep.
This next pair of portraits are two of my favorites in the Salisbury Association's collection. The sitter is a man named Augustus Miles. It's attributed to that other itinerant, naive painter, Army Phillips. Now, both Army Phillips and Erastus Salisbury Field are in all the art history books. They are very listed as perfect examples of this kind of painting. And, of course, they're mostly portraits. And this is also, again, that sort of wonderful, realistic, and even though this hand sort of looks like a lobster claw, but that's kind of charming. I mean, you know, I'm sure he wasn't too worried about it, but, and this one looks as though he's missing a thumb. It's not that technically proficient, but there is definitely this sort of charm to them. If we can then look to his, I guess his cousin, was it, Catherine?
What?
William Miles wasn't a brother, was it?
They were cousins.
Cousin, that's what I thought. Okay, thank you.
And what year was it painted?
I'm sorry? Oh, in the 1830s to 40s. We don't have an exact date. And this is William Miles, which also kind of, the hand is a lot better. And it's a little bit more proficient. It's less of the sort of naive quality, but a wonderful, the contrast between the stark whiteness of his shirt and his black coat against that kind of neutral background, which was often used for portraits so that the sitter's face would stand out, and the sitter's likeness would stand out, and you weren't distracted by other things. Later on, portrait painters would include other things in the background because it would give a clue to that person's character and profession. And Thomas Aikens did that in that picture of his professor, painting of his professor friend. But, you know, this is a kind of very realistic picture. Now, there's another characteristic of American portraits of this period, and that there was no pulling punches. The earlier portraits in the grand manner, the artist would embellish, would indicate that sort of, if they were painting a portrait of a woman, they might make the neck a little longer to give it a more elegant look. But in this case, and a man would be given a prominent position, and make him look tall, but in this case they didn't care. They wanted a likeness, including this kind of pleated shirt, which I think is kind of neat. So these are those two pictures. I really, they, for some reason, they remain some of my favorite, two of my favorite pictures in the collection. Now, this is kind of, this whole thing is kind of, and we're going to need the light in a minute because I have something on an easel I want to show in relation to this. I don't have, for some reason, and I can't figure out why, but I don't have the oil painting of this subject, but we do have, which is my fault, but this is an etching of John Milton Holly, and who was painted by a local artist, who was later painted by a local artist named Edwin White. And it would be kind of fun to do a little bit more research into Edwin White. He painted a lot of pictures, a lot of local worthies in the 1840s or so in this area, particularly in Salisbury. So you'll see that name a lot in connection with these portraits. Now, so far, these portraits that I, this one and the previous portraits are all in the collection of the association in Academy House. Some of the pictures belonging to the association are also in Town Hall. So you do want to, it's kind of interesting, as Catherine points out, that, you know, you go pay your taxes, and to ease the pain, you might look at some of these pictures. So this is John Milton Holly. He died in 1836, but the etching, we're not sure whether the etching was made while he was still alive or made, probably. But White was then commissioned to do an oil painting. So in preparation for the oil painting, he made a charcoal drawing from this etching. And there's the charcoal drawing, which is, again, up in Academy House. It's not framed, it's very fragile, but it's, so you have this charcoal drawing. Now, so he made the charcoal drawing, which was, and the problem with showing images like this often is that the size and the scale is off. I showed that etching, it's really, the etching's about this big, okay? This is a little closer, it's still bigger than the actual size, but it's closer. Now, so he is then commissioned to do a portrait, posthumous portrait of the artist, of the sitter, and this is about 1844, the sitter died in 1836. So what does he do? He put places over this something called pounce paper. May I have the light, please? And here is the actual paper. It's really a kind of translucent sheet of paper in which it's laid over the portrait and with tiny sort of pinpricks. You follow the line, the pinpricks would follow the line of that drawing. This is a charcoal, okay? And then you connect the dots, so to speak, and come up with something like this, which is then transferred to the actual canvas. And that's how he That was how he, and this was common practice at the time.
How was it transferred?
Because it's laid on the canvas, and because of these dots, the charcoal is then filtered through the dots and appears on the canvas itself. Mm-hmm. So it becomes a, so it's a way of, it's like a rubbing, exactly, uh-huh. Exactly. And so we have in the association, not only is there the oil painting, the final oil painting by White, there is the etching from which he took the oil painting. There is the charcoal. There is this. So you have a whole progression. You have how the artist painted this. And so you get some idea of how an artist actually worked at that time. So I thought that was kind of fun. Okay, let's go. Yeah, thanks. And we'll go to the next one. I had to jump on this one because now here we have a marvelous example of the straightforward realist style in George Coffin Churchill. George Churchill Coffin, right. Okay. I knew that. So, marvelous picture. He's got, again, it's all part, he has a kind of using elements of the grand manner, which meant you've got a curtain, a big drape behind the sitter. You have a landscape in the background, presumably it's his. It's either a train or his factory, and he's sitting there, very much a successful businessman of his time. I did have another. I had a photo of Maria Holly, which unfortunately didn't take. But I think it's interesting that within, while I talk about this, I thought it was, this was done in 1844 as well, and I did think it's, it was interesting. I did want that photo of Maria Holly, but somehow or other, it didn't take in the computer. So, but it's also interesting that the photo was there, and for the time, that's great because we had this whole new medium of photography, which is also represented, and I think that's kind of interesting within this time period. The photography will of course become more and more important later on. Until today, we are virtually inundated with photographic images. So, but this is a great example of that kind of realism where the artist is technically proficient, but not flashy, and not naive or primitive. This is that middle way of portrait painting. So let us continue. This is also one of my favorite drawings. This is an artist I never heard of called Stephen Falk, F-A-L-K. I have a colleague and a friend named Peter Falk. Not the actor. and this is an actress named Fanny Gillette. in costume for orphans of the storm. And this is undated. You could date it probably if you looked up when Orphans of the Storm was produced and shown. But I think it's great. It's a pastel, and she's looking like Lillian Gish, who was, of course, the star of the only Orphans of the Storm that I ever heard of, and which is a film by D.W. Griffiths, in one of the most famous of the silent era films. So, which I love to make that connection, but I'm not on movies. And any time I can make a connection to a movie, I'll do it, regardless of whether it makes sense or not. but I think it's a joke. What was that? But it's a wonderful, charming period drawing, a very kind of Victorian, full of that sort of Victorian sentiment and atmosphere. Now, whether what intrigues me is whether or not she was part of the Gillette acting family. William Gillette, for example, was one of the first film actors to play Sherlock Holmes. He had that kind of profile. And his house, of course, is in castle. On the other side of the state, near what, Old Boyle?
Haddam.
Right. Haddam, that's Haddam. Right, it's in Haddam. So it would be kind of interesting to find out if there were a connection between this Gillette and William Gillette, same family, actors. Seems logical. Anyway, that's kind of fun. So if we go further to on here, I don't know if now, if I can find this on my list, we had a little bit of a technical problem in the beginning. Here we are. This is Maria Birch Coffin. Again, painted by Edwin White, who is very ubiquitous here. It's with Jane Winslow in the background. This is fascinating because here we are in New England, and it's very possible. I mean, why would anyone put, in the first place, there are paintings with the servant in it, but the servant is serving. There are several early colonial pictures with, in fact, black servants, but there you could tell that they are actually acting in that capacity. Here, she seems to be peering around the corner, and in fact, not even looking at the sitter, but looking beyond her. And the whole sort of speculation is, was she a slave? This is painted in 1844, so prior to the Civil War, obviously. Was she a slave? Was she an indentured servant? Was she just a servant? Was she a free person of color and a servant? Interesting to speculate about, and that's what portraits do. That's what they imply certain things, and they create a kind of interest and how that you might want to go further in exploring, you know. So that's kind of and it's beautifully painted. This is a fabulous portrait, beautifully painted.
Maybe she was a daughter.
I'm sorry?
Maybe she was a daughter. No.
Daughter?
No, she wasn't a daughter.
Now that raises another question. But
don't you think
that's interesting?
She
It's possible, but it sounds a bit like a kind of television.
Yeah. But it seems gone like with it was the wind. Important.
Well, I'm sorry?
It seems like, for some reason, it was really important.
Oh, absolutely. But she was obviously important to the family, whatever the situation was, whether slave or not, or whatever her own situation was, she was important to the family. Mm-hmm. And that's, but she looks pretty stern, you know, the sort of New England Puritan look. Anyway, so that raises all that kind of this. It would be fun to come in. It's available if you want to do some research. It's going to be go see Catherine and go upstairs. Actually, I'm serious. If anybody has an interest, that's what this collection is for. Not just to look at, but if you want to take it further, you want to explore and find out more about it, why not? It's here, and it's open to the public. So anyway, here we go. Let's see what's next. Ah, now this is not in, this is the library's picture. Claudia would kill me if I didn't mention that.
Where does it hang in the library?
It's the Scoville sisters.
Above her desk.
You check things out, look up.
Where is it hanging?
Oh, it's hanging in the library.
You walk past
the computers, turn around and look up, and there it is. Along with another portrait by Ellen Emmett Rand. Mm. This is by Ellen Emmett Rand in what I call her sergeant phase.
Yeah.
Very much like John Singer's Sargent, that incredible painting in the Tate, maybe in London, called the Wyndham Sisters, which is a tour de force. Only there are three of them, and the gestures and everything else is far more dramatic than this. But this is very much that whole gesture is a typically Sargent kind of thing. This is wonderful, this mm-hmm. gesture. Mm-hmm. Very kind of person playing with necklace. It's a terrific portrait by Ellen Emmett Rand, who of course was really Salisbury's resident portrait painter for many, many years. I show this, even though I thought it was important to show this, even though it's not part of the actual Salisbury Association collection, but it is part of the town, and it's part of the culture and art of the town. So I thought it was, I thought it was interesting because of that kind of sergeant, as opposed to some of her other portraits, which we'll see in a minute. And I think I do, in fact, have a, there's a sergeant. Oh. That's John Singer's sergeant, Mrs. Fisk Warren, and her daughter Rachel. Warrens were very big in New York and Newport. And this picture was painted in around 1903, and the Scoville sisters were painted around 1900. So there is a sort of similar time period. And this is sort of typically Sargent, who was, of course, the painter, the one American painter who painted the transatlantic establishment. Traveled between London, New York, Newport, Philadelphia, and back to London. He was the artist of his time. What we would say today, he was the go-to artist if you wanted your portrait painted. So there, but I show that to sort of emphasize the influence on element that ran in this picture. Okay. Now, if we go a little bit further than this, this is a painting. Elizabeth, it's been attributed to Cecilia Beau, the Philadelphia portrait painter, but I don't think that's right. Elizabeth Barton Carter, painted about 1905, 1907, and attributed to Cecilia Beau. I had a Cecilia Beau to compare with it, but unfortunately, I think it was one of those paintings that didn't take on my disc. But I don't think this is anywhere near Cecilia Beau, but it's a nice painting. And so it represents now the later, of a later period, as we leave the sort of naive and primitive style of the 1830s and 40s, which we've been looking at. And we have here a kind of more sophisticated, somewhat Sargent-esque, somewhat more sophisticated, more trained approach to a sort of wonderful kind of background things, that marvelous hat with the huge flowers. So we're now getting up in time, and there is, so I couldn't get my Cecilia Beau. This is Judge Donald Ticknor Warner, painted by Element at Rand in 1921. So you have this terrific realist. I mean, that's coming a little closer to Elegance in this picture. I think this is a fabulous portrait, and it's owned by the town, and is in Town Hall. I don't think you want to look at this while you're paying your taxes, but he looks pretty stern. So you know, you might feel guilty if you look at this. But it's one. I mean, it's very. The composition is very Whistler. It's very much like Whistler. If you think about Whistler's mother, the kind of profile portrait. A lot of portrait painters loved profiles because they make interesting shapes, for one thing, and to a lot of portrait painters, they're an indication of character if you show someone in profile. Mm-hmm. But here, if you look at the way she uses white, you have the white of the paper he's holding, his cuffs going up, and it's much brighter here because you focus on the face. It's like Fred Astaire. Now, before you look at me quizzically for mentioning Fred Astaire would wear bright socks because he wanted you to focus on his feet. Mm-hmm. He was a dancer. In this case, this is a portrait, and she wanted you to focus on his face. And so this tone of that white is very discreet, or it's more discreet than either the cuffs or the collar. So you come like this, and you get to, it's a very interesting face. This is a wonderful book. And of course, that's in Town Hall. So, and the last one is this marvelous painting by Ellen Emmett Rand. Again, it's owned by the association, but it's on loan to Town Hall. And it is a man named Davy Jones. And in fact, it's called Davy Jones of Mount Riga. And, I mean, it's wonderful. Mm-hmm. Look at that. I mean, incredible sort of quizzical, I mean, he's sort of looking, sort of looking at it, you know, why me?
Yes, yes, yes.
Why are you painting me? But it's a wonderful, this was done in 1926. And so you have in this area all of these incredible, and this is just a superficial kind of look, a surface look at what is in the Salisbury Association, the library, and the town hall. And that's kind of neat. And I think it was fun to show them, to look at them, to study them. And I would hope by doing so that you would do the same. Thank you very much.